I'd like to say, first of all, how pleased I am to be here tonight as a representative, and I don't think that's too strong a word, of Her Majesty's government to declare our unswerving support for whatever you're supporting here tonight. This is, in fact, my first visit to a hovercraft. And it's been of tremendous interest to one whose knowledge of coal mining has been confined to one or two brief visits to Jodrell Bank. Only last week I visited another reservoir in North Wales. And there I was here, I found the same spirit of cooperation between parents and teachers, which I believe to be vital to an integrated transport system in our docks. Four, I declare these magnificent toilets open. I say to you all, fearlessly and frankly, long live Britain's bakers. May they continue to entertain us with the finest transistors, since vertical takeoff aircraft replace computers as our main source of food. We must indeed save the whales, but let us not save them for too long. Thank you very much. Well, I don't get much chance to watch television nowadays, though I did very much enjoy the coronation of George VI. But here tonight is one of my favourite performers, a performer of amazing talent and skill. Ladies and gentlemen, may I ask you to welcome for the first time here on this stage of the Opera House in Milan, Mr. Stoop Solo. Thank you very much.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's wonderful to be. You know, that's not my goal, and it's been very lucky for me. Thank you. The champagne was Canadian. The hostess sang a song. I contemplated suicide. Then you came along. You're so spontaneous. You hit the spot. Nothing but everything is all you've got. You're so spontaneous. You top the bill. Your arrogance at the fair gives me a thrill. For this is the moment is now, the moment is you. Come on, take your bow, you're so spontaneous. You knock me flat, you pull those little white rabbits out of my top hat. You're so spontaneous. A brack of the broad. Spontaneous. That's what you are.
Take it first.
The moment is now, the moment is you. Come on, take your bow, you're so spontaneous. It's wonderful, spontaneous, spontaneous. That's what you are.
Good evening. As you may or may not know, we are
the management.
We manage things. We think management is a two-way thing. For instance, you manage to pay us the money, we might manage to leave you alone. You don't manage to pay us the money, you might not be able to manage to...
walk.
Oh dear, Ron, they're laughing.
Oh no, Ron.
Ladies and gentlemen, don't laugh at Ron. Laughing at Ron is bad.
Bad Ron.
So don't laugh no more.
More Ron.
To the business of why we're all here tonight. I can describe for you why we're here tonight with one single little word. And that word is...
murder.
Charity.
Oh yeah, charity.
Everybody's got their own contraception of what charity's about. But me and Ron believe that those in need should be given.
And those who don't give should be need.
I don't like clapping.
I don't like Brighton.
Charity. So what are me and Ron going to do for charity, I hear you ask?
I didn't hear nothing.
I'm going to tell you what we're going to do. In aid of this worthy cause, me and Ron are going to do a sponsored fret. Shut up. The fret comes in three easy-to-listen-to packages. The £5 skinflint fret.
Cough up the money or you'll be coughing up blood.
The £20 household economy fret.
If you're naughty, I'm going to suck your eye out of your socket, swallow it so that you can see my point of view.
And for any rich people in the audience,
like you,
the special 150 quid Super Deluxe Limited Edition fret.
If you don't come across with the spondulix, I'm going to have to remove the soles of your feet with a bacon slicer.
Very big with the Sainsbury's family, that one. Listen, give generously.
Or else.
And remember, you have my personal assurance. Every single penny you spend down here tonight will go straight to charity. Enough said.
A grim and ghostly darkness settled over the streets of North London. The streetlights cast their dingy glow onto the gloomy winter clouds. The silence was broken only by the hooting of a very gifted bat. The moon was full, and astronauts queued outside. Somewhere a wild dog howled madly, but it was in Tokyo Zoo, so nobody heard it. The wind whistled all through the night, and other Welsh hymns. A car pulled up outside 15 Birchwood Close. Nigel was giving Shirley a lift home. Nigel was a fine young man. Heart of gold, nerves of steel, alabaster feet and a knob of butter. He hoped Shirley would invite him in for coffee, or better still, some rampant sex. Last time he recalled, all he got was a peck on the cheek, but that's one of the hazards of keeping a parrot in your underpants. Why don't you come to my flat for some rampant sex, said Shirley. Nigel could hardly believe his ears, but then nobody could, they were 3 feet long and covered in fur. There's one thing I must tell you, though. I'm not on the pill, said Nigel. Don't worry, said Shirley, put this on. It was the Beach Boys' greatest hits. They gazed at each other. Their eyes met to form one huge eye that could see in all directions. Nigel broke the silence. He apologised and opened the window. mixing with the music and wine, they slowly started to undress. There was a slight moment of embarrassment for Nigel. When he took his underpants off, the power fell out. They sat opposite each other, naked on the bed. Shirley had the most perfect breasts. He leaned towards her. They embraced. And there aren't many breasts that can do that. Nigel licked his lips. He then licked the small of his back, which for my money beats the breast trick. They made love. Nigel, she said afterwards, am I the first girl you ever made love to? I don't know, said Nigel. Were you stuck in a lift in Harrods in 1974?
I went down Harley Street yesterday.
Did you?
Down where the clinic's on there.
Oh, right, yeah.
Down the artificial inseminatory unit. Sperm bank.
Right, yeah.
Because they got the biggest collection of sperms in the country down here.
Right, and what, so you went down to have a sort of look at them, did you?
No, I went down to stick some in. I'm going to go later.
How do you do that then?
No, I mean, how come?
How does it come about that you are
like a donor?
Oh, right,
yeah. Well, see, there's a lot of women in the world, right?
That's true, yeah.
And a lot of them, like, for various reasons,
yeah.
They can't get pregnant.
No, right.
Because basically, their husbands haven't got it in them.
Well, not at all.
Well, not as much as I.
No.
What they need is a virile, manly sperm.
Yeah.
Stuck in there,
right.
To do business with it.
Right, yeah.
I'm not being too technical.
No, no, no. So how many of these women are there?
Hundreds.
You're older than I thought you were. And when you go down there, right, to this, what it's like, this unit, right, but do you get a choice then? Woman, then, when you go down there?
No. You don't actually see the woman.
So it's sort of like a home then. Well, you're sort of doing the lights out, you know, just
no, 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 no. The woman is not actually there.
Oh, right. Where is she then?
Doing the shopping around her head, aren't I? I mean, she's not expecting it there and then.
No, right. So it's sort of exactly like at home, then. You just
not sneak up. No, no, no. Look, it's a bank, right?
Oh, right, yeah.
It's a sperm,
yeah.
Bank.
It's a bank, yeah.
See, if I go down there, I leave a little deposit, and she comes along, and she makes a little withdrawal.
Right,
it's a bank, it's a sperm bank.
I expect there's a bit of a queue on Friday night tonight. Yeah. So when you go down, right, down to the bank, right, what sort of happens then?
Well, it's very straightforward, actually. I mean, there's nothing to it. It's a bit like giving blood, and one little prick and it's over.
Yeah. And do they sort of like give you a hand then?
Sort of half full,
or whatever. Yeah.
So how do they, you know, how does it come about that you get down there, you know, when you go down there?
Well, basically, I mean, you've got to be matched, you see, you've got to be matched up.
Yeah,
I mean, like, see, the husband of the woman, of the woman, has got to be a little bit like me.
I see. But bald.
No, same hair and eye colour.
Oh, right, yeah. Do you think I could do that then? Mm. Go down there?
No. They've got the right temperament for it, really.
No, I see.
Now, you see, the people sort of man that they're looking for down there, a man with... Well, it's obviously, it's a man with a bit of class.
Yeah.
It's a man with a bit of quality, a man with a little savvy, a man with a little bit of something up top, you know.
Well, and a man who likes wanking in your balls, I suppose.
You're always aware on these occasions that you're not the first person they asked. The first person they asked is usually James Galway. He's not here. So for those of you who are hoping to see him, here is a tribute. The finest flute player Northern Ireland has ever produced.
Left to the right. This is make it your brother like I was in Belfast. You fake away your boy doing a fight. And when you are playing on your tin whistle, under the eye of a guided missile, gets to be a happy looking like a frightened rabbit. Once the food did a bomb in it, and they said you've got a minute, that he's probably the reason I'm playing so fast. Boy, don't worry, I start from left to the right. I'm looking for the camera which has got the little light on. Checking to see that I'm in a line fight. Trying to resemble a kind of macho leprechaun William on his chat show. Answering the questions on my mind, it is suggestions if I have to tell again about the way I joined the bird in Philharmonic, I should almost certainly be sick. What do I have from left to right? Have to keep a good eye on the stopwatch when I have started the bumblebee's life. They all expect the previous record will be wrecked. I have to play it ever far. Only there'll be a disaster. I shall make the things agree that the flute went met. Why do my eyes start from right to left? Well, if I'm honest, it's fear of theft. This thing I hold isn't very old, and it's gold. So why are you running that if I relax or shut either eye than a man with an axe or a cup makes off all around me? Why do my eyes start from left to the right? Cause the conductor is now behind me. He used to be well in my line of sight. But I was only in the band, I am only at the front, so I decided all the faster pieces I did look up and just play easy things like Annie's song and the occasional obbligato wobbling around with a huge vibrato. Can't go on forever, no, it must stop. One day they'll let me play a concerto again instead of bless this house on stars on Sunday.
I should not like to think this evening was about to get classical, so I should put on this. This is Blues Singers Kit number 9A. This is what Blues Singers wore before they got their freedom. What I'd like to do for you now is a genuine down-home, not messed around with, not rhythm and blues jazz front. A genuine blues. It comes from a show called Starlight Express. The first line of the blues is always sung a second time. Yes, the first line of the blues is always sung a second time. So by the time you get to the third line, you've had time to think of a rhyme. There ain't no law that says that the line gotta be different at all. No, there ain't no law that says that the line gotta be different at all. I know there ain't no law that says that the line gotta be different at all. I woke up this morning, got a note from my woman which said, yes, I woke up this morning, I got a
note from our woman who said, didn't say that, just have repeated it. It said, to me, don't gonna let me, cause I play the mouth organ in there. From your best friend.
It's very nice to be here. I was very flattered to be asked to come on, because they phoned me up and they said, we'd like you to do a charity show. We didn't really want you, we wanted the thin one, but never mind. But it's very nice to be here, and it's very nice of you to take the trouble to come out here this evening, because you could have stayed in and had a lovely cosy domestic evening at home, couldn't you? You young couples. Daphne, why is your Dutch cap on the draining board?
What?
I don't recommend them Dutch caps. No, because they're too small to make your ears itch. So, excuse me, just having a bit of trouble with my latex discontinued. The terrible thing is bras. I read this thing once in a magazine, and it was a test to see whether you needed to wear one or not. And the test was, if you could hold a pencil underneath. It's very depressing for me. I think I could hold a small branch of W.H. Smith. Lifted and separate anyway. I mean, they've got to meant them to be lifted and separated. It was one on each shoulder. That's magazines for you, see, they just set you worrying. And they're all sending a copy off each other. I mean, if Cosmopolitan comes out one month with an article, orgasms and how to get them, Woman's Realm will be there the week after, orgasms and how to knit them. I read a very serious article this morning in Cosmopolitan. It was called, Sexual Harassment at Work. Is it a problem for the self-employed? Just got to help your voice holes out, this is the only other thing. Because I've had trouble with the cold. Well, snot I've had trouble with. This is why we do charity shows, so we can say words like snot. But I think it's right. I've got this stuff, Sinex, and you put it up in there and it all goes. And you think, well, that's marvellous, where does it go? Take your socks off and you find out. Now, see, I've been swimming, that's why I've got a cold. I go to this very posh pool at White City. There's a terrible draft when the greyhounds go past. It's mainly women, you know. Got the odd man ploughing up and down like a hairy torpedo. But mainly it's women. And they all swim with their heads out of the water. Says not to splash their cigarette. And I went, and I lost a contact lens, and they had to drain the whole pool. And I was so embarrassed, I just grabbed the first thing I could see. And I think this is a verruca. So I thought, well, I'd go to the doctor. Well, I hadn't been to the doctor for years, not since I thought you had to be inoculated for the Isle of Man. I still feel you should be. And I went to this little back street and I saw this plaque that said, Dr. Greville, fully qualified doctor and carpet fitter. Let us loosely, your manual. So I went in, and there's a room full of very sort of poorly looking people, you know, even the goldfish has a little scarf around its neck. And the receptionist said, can I help you? And I said, yes, you could put that machine gun down, please. I said, can I see the doctor? She said, I'm afraid that's not possible. I said, well, can you draw me a picture of him? By the time I got him to see him, you know, the price of his fingers had gone up three times. But he obviously liked to drink, you know, because the surgical spirit was lying up next to the slim line tonic and the ice bucket. And he had a touch of the DTs. I thought at first his desk had just clicked on to final rinse and spin. And I remember this thing about, you're supposed to go to your chemist, you see, not the doctor, because chemists know everything. So of course there's a huge queue of people checking up on the theory of relativity. So shall I ask the assistant? Well, she looked a bit dim, you know, she stood there buffing up her engagement ring with a bunny in her hand. But no, it's nice to know people can be vacant and engaged, you know, at the same time. There's going to be a party tonight if we finish in time. I'm not very good at parties. I always get there too early. I always get everywhere too early. Turned up at funerals before people have died. I'm just not really good at talking to people, so I always end up sort of clearing glasses and wiping ashtrays. I get invitations now that say, don't bring a bottle, bring a damp cloth. And I always get stuck with those men that nobody else wants to talk to. Remember one with the most terrible toupee? I thought it was he had a very tired gerbil on the top of his head. Kissing him, you see, because this seemed preferable to talking to him. And he was the sort that gets his tongue right in there, you know, just a good root round. And they said, what's the matter? You know, have you dropped something behind my tongue? I can't escape from boring people who are always getting stuck on landings with couples who've done their own conveyancing. Once I got stuck with a man who did his own vasectomy. Surely you need one other person, you know, just to put their finger on the knot. You can't leave a party. If you're trying to leave early, there's somebody having sex on your anorak. Your bums are mine, thank you. Look, getting terribly cross. I'm going to really lower the tone. This is a little monologue for Christmas, entitled, It Was Christmas Eve in the Crescent. It was Christmas Eve in the Crescent. All the children were in their pyjamas. All the parents were snappy, tense and happy, except two who were in the Bahamas. A child lay asleep in his bedroom. He was horribly red-faced and porky. He'd caused family rifts by requesting his gifts, a computer, £10 and a Yorkie. In the lounge sat his mother and father, in not the most pleasant of humours. Grandma was there, collapsed in a chair, having just overdosed on satsumas. Room that evening, they had a gas fire but they lost it. It was frozen and murky and so was the turkey, they left it too late to defrost it. The door of the lounge room burst open. There stood Santa Claus reeking of liquor. He said, I'm 19 stone two, I get stuck down the flue, I come through the door because it's quicker. Well, what do you fancy for Christmas, said Santa, all twinkly and merry. A fur coat or a bike, you can have what you like. In the meantime, bung over the sherry. Well, they couldn't decide what they wanted. A new car, a subscription to Booper, a pedestal mat. Well, they thought about that. Father Christmas passed out in a stupor. He was out of his brains, he was legless. The late night and the sherry had wrecked him. He lay on the floor till a quarter to four until reindeer arrived to collect him. Well, Santa waved from the sleigh and said, see you, Merry Christmas and be of good cheer. As he rose from the crescent, Mom said, where's our presents? He said, oh, sorry, I'll bring next year. Thank you for that.
Because Rob has organised, I think, a wonderful bill of people to amuse you tonight, an absolute galaxy of stars,
Absolutely.
A panoply, a real covey of talent here tonight.
And bubble and squeak of talent.
And we're the reason we're here, and I think everybody else is here, if I may be serious just for a moment, is because we believe that this is absolutely a very good cause to be involved in. To my mind, in many respects, the war in Guatemala has become a sort of rotten thing. And at Christmas time, people just don't really think, do they, about the refugees. And of course, there's no reason particularly why they should. It's obviously not. I think really sort of charity begins at home, doesn't it? In many respects, what's sort of like with the minus, is it? The minus children there? Not, I mean, Parkinson's disease, is it? Well, it's not the deaf and dumb at all. It's not those kind of people. Well, the GLC. Good. Mm. Oh, no, it's not the Actors Museum again. No.
oncology.
Oh, I'm sorry, oncology. Of course. Yeah. Well, there we are, ladies and gentlemen. We've all gathered here tonight to raise, we hope, a lot of money for the study of fossilized seashells.
We're all here tonight, ladies and gentlemen, to put money forward to the Oncology Club Fund. And that's where you've come in, because you all paid an incredible amount of money to be here tonight. I know that. People down here have paid an absolutely obscene amount of money. Actually, in fact, madam, how much exactly did you pay for your ticket? Oh, sorry, hello, darling. Oh, you didn't pay anything at all. Did John get his comp, okay? Oh, fine. Madam, how much did you pay?
No, that's Alexi Sales au pair over there.
Ingrid! Okay. Oh, look, there's Richard Stilgo's piano teacher down there. Right. I say, you Richard Stilgo's piano teacher! Yeah.
My friends down here, that's good to see. But up there, you've paid an enormous amount up there. I mean, I say an enormous, obviously it seems an enormous amount now, you'll laugh later on. You may not laugh now, but you will laugh later on. That sum, because all the money that's been gathered...
All of the money that you have paid for your tickets is going to be put together into a big, what do you call it, sort of...
Suitcase?
Yeah, big suitcase. Yeah.
And some of that money will go to the Oncology Fund. I say some, because obviously, in a great big show like tonight, you know, obviously, you know, there are a few incidental expenses along the way. Obviously, you can't do a show like this without props.
You know. You can't do comedy without props.
Absolutely. And a big cast like this manages to drink their way through quite a few props during the course of an evening.
But please bear in mind that we are talking about very, very tiny sums. For example, just £1 can provide a whole new wardrobe for the Flying Pickets. And of course, it benefits Oxfam at the same time. So you see.
So there are a few, obviously, incidental expenses, you know, like tickets and printing posters and that sort of things, and administration.
That's right. Yes, publicity, and because we don't come cheap.
So we thought that with one way or another with the funds, we had a whip round backstage, we've come up with an item for a charity auction here, which we hope you'll help us out in. These are Rick Mayall's trousers. Ladies and gentlemen, and we're going to ask you, these are the actual trousers that Rick Mayall wore at his recent sellout concert at the beginning of his tour there, where he went on in front of 20,000 people without a script. Slightly soiled, as you can imagine. But an authentic piece of early 80s comedy memorabilia there, and I think I'd like to start the bidding at a reasonable sum here. Can we start the bidding at 5p? Is there anybody here at all who's willing to bid 5p for this wonderful pair? I'm seriously, ladies and gentlemen, this man has given his trousers for this event here tonight, an absolutely unique pair. I don't believe he does actually have any other pair of trousers here. Can I ask for 5p? Well, let's start in more sensible, £200. Nobody here is prepared to bid £200 for Rick Mayall's trousers. We've got somebody up there. £5, sir? £5?
£5.
I have to warn you that the Spiro Agnew Museum of Comedy in New York has put a reserve bid in on these trousers. And we're not really getting any takers at all for Rick Mayall's trousers.
I've got a bidder from that state, in fact. I think you've got them, sir.
Anyways, yeah, you're not Rick Mayall, are you?
No, but they're my bleeding trousers.
I'm Wally. I'm not a real Wally though. I haven't been working for British Telecom long enough for that. I'm doing my training. Everybody who works for British Telecom has to do 6 months training with complicated wiring and that. Then when you've learned to do your shoelace, you know, you're fully Wally. I support Mulville.
Mulville, get away, you know. Hey, get away,
whatever that means. It's great down there, Walk. I like going down there, especially when they're playing at home. See, I've got a friend down Millwall, like, with a skinhead haircut painted red, white and blue, and Millwall skins are all okay tattooed in the middle of it. Her name's Julie. My name's not Julie, though. My name's Bill, short for umbilical. When I was born, they threw the baby away, kept me. A war baby, I was. Yeah, because people used to look in a pram and go, "Ooh, look at him." I had a girlfriend once, till my brother let the air out of her. I like girls, I do. I like you. Will you marry me? I'm very good in bed. Go straight to sleep. I don't need to anyway, I've got a mummy. I love my mummy. My mummy's big and cuddly and easy to spell. Cut at her, mum. I wish my name was Sharon, after Sharon Davis, because she's my hero, Sharon Davis. I dream about her every night. I had a dream about her last night. I dreamt that she took all my clothes off and rubbed my naked body with Campbell's cream of chicken soup. Then I woke up and found a bit lumpy sick all down my journey. See you later, all right?
Hello. Today, we're going to be looking how you can change the kind of person that you are. It's called changing character, isn't it? Today, we're going to be using hats. Maybe you've got a hat. Might you go and get it now? Play with us. Dawn's going to be helping me today. Can you see Dawn? She's over there. Hello, Dawn.
Hello, Jenny. Here I am. Standing in the play area.
What kind of hat have you found, Dawn?
Shall we look? I found this kind of hat. It's a red one, isn't it? What kind of hat did you find, Jenny?
Let's look. Blue hat. Should we put them on? Perhaps you'd like to put your hat on now as well.
Have you become, Jenny?
Sleepy potato picker, I think, don't you?
Yes, that was an easy one, wasn't it?
What kind of person are you, Dawn?
Let's see. Did you guess? I'm a lunatic, aren't I?
That was fun, wasn't it? Tomorrow, Tomorrow, we're going to be looking at shoes. So we'll see you then. Bye.
Let me say what a pleasure it is. What a pleasure it is to be back here in your little, tiny, infinitesimal speck of an island once again. You know, I'd like to sing a song at you now, made famous by myself. But I certainly hope that this song means as much to you as it does to me. Thank you. So I face the final curtain. My friends, I'll say it clear. I'll state my case, of which I am certain. I've lived a
life in store. Our eternal each and every highway. More, much more than this, I didn't want. Regrets? Oh, that's you. But there we are. Too few to mention. I did what I had to do. I saw it through without exemption. To think I did all that. And may I say, not in a shy way. No more, much more than this. I did it my way. He's there old times, I'm sure you knew. When I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. The record shows, I took the blows, and it is my way. I love you.
Evening?
Good evening.
What do you do?
Oh, I'm a fire-eating lion tamer.
Oh, yes, yes. I'm an accountant. Chartered accountant. Where do you live?
Oh, I live in a converted monastery in the Outer Hebrides.
Oh, really? Very interesting, yeah. I live in Hendon.
Yeah, lovely.
Is your wife here tonight?
No. She's in El Salvador, fighting.
Oh, very brave. Very brave. Do you know Hendon at all?
I think I may have passed through it once. Oh, yes, I was being kidnapped by Russian agents.
Operating. Where were they taking you?
They were taking me to a frigate they'd got waiting for me in the Thames estuary.
Then you'd have gone down Alverston Road, past our house. Blue door, white letter box at the bottom, do you remember?
Well, I'm afraid I wouldn't really remember. You see, I've been pretty heavily drugged with hypertalcin metoprolol.
Oh, well, what does that do?
Oh, it's a knockout drug that paralyzes the memory cells.
Oh, does it affect the eyesight?
No, yes, you're totally unconscious.
Oh, well, you wouldn't have seen the house anyway. Number 37 on the corner, you must pop in sometime.
Well, that's very kind of you, but I'm afraid I won't be able to. I've got to go to prison.
Oh dear. Not in Hendon, I suppose.
No, not in Hendon. Matter of fact, it's in Guatemala.
Oh.
Just a little currency offence they picked me up for when I was out there investigating a man-eating cactus.
You went all the way to Guatemala to see a cactus?
Yes, it was pretty unpleasant. The tent was full of poisonous snails and I was practically trampled to death by rogue buffalo.
Just looking for a cactus. If only I'd met you earlier, they had a display of them in Hendon Central Library. Two whole shelves full of them. I could have lent you my ticket.
Well, wouldn't there be any need for that? As a matter of fact, I'm a freeman of the City of London, so I can get in anywhere, anytime.
Oh, just as well, because I don't think the tickets were transferable. You know, it's really fascinating talking to you, because it's not everyone that's interested in Hendon.
Look, I'll show you something that'll really interest you.
Oh.
Have you ever seen one of these before?
No.
Do you know what it is?
No.
It's a Tibetan prayer shawl. Any idea how I got it?
No, I haven't.
It was given to me by the chief slave girl of the commander of the Tibetan army. Oh, God, she was a beauty. Hair as black as raven's wings. One evening...
Yeah?
It was on the feast of Ramsidasi, the all-powerful god of light, when 10,000 cattle are sacrificed on the mountain. She crept into my room, filling it with a delightful fragrance. she cast away her tribal robe, and her dark hair spilled across her delicate pale skin as she climbed into my bed.
Really?
Yes. She gave him Hendon.
Before I declare this meeting open, I have something very serious to tell you about. Somebody has been going behind my back. So devious have they been, so underhand, and so clever. But not only do I not know who they are, I'm not quite sure what it is they've done. Yet. But beware. I'm on my guard. Now, if Mr. Jones would read the minutes of the last meeting.
Certainly. The minutes of the 42nd meeting of the Crawley and District Paranoid Society. The meeting was duly convened and Mr. Innes gave us a very spirited talk about the holes that his next door neighbours have been drilling in his walls. Then he went on to say, yeah, someone's been tampering with his notes.
What? I said, someone's been tampering with his notes.
Well, look, you don't believe me, do you?
So don't believe me, he's coming to me, he's coming to me. He's coming to me. Get him, come down.
Shh, calm down, please. Perhaps, perhaps Mr. McGrath would like to calm us down with one of his little jokes.
Well, there was these two men sitting, and one says to the other, who was that lady I saw you with last night? And the other fella says, you've been following me again!
I'm sorry, somebody was staring at me maliciously.
He's blaming me again! He's blaming me again!
I'm out of here!
Come here by yourself!
Just calm down! Shh. I can hear the sound of tape recorders whirring.
I can hear bombers!
Shh! I can hear intercontinental ballistic missiles! Help! Help! Help!
Oh. It's my mistake. I was wrong.
I think now would be an appropriate time for the Reverend Palin to lead us in the club prayer.
Oh dear Lord, who cares for us, guides us, and watches over every move we make. I'll speak more quiet.
Our Father,
whose is eye on us in heaven, hallowed be thy pseudonym. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, behind our backs in heaven as it is on earth. Set us this day our daily bread, and then start talking about us to the next person in the queue as soon as we've left the shop. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that we have a pretty shrewd idea of trespassing against us. Forever and ever.
Amen. Meeting closed.
God, bloody bamboo shoot. I could kill a curry. Oh, hello. It's the human enclosure. Oh, don't they look sweet? Excuse me, are you two together? You are? Go on then. Go on, give her one. You see, it's not so easy when people are watching, is it? Oh, the name's Wang Wang, by the way. I'm a present from the government of China to Margaret Thatcher as a symbol of peace and harmony between our two great nations. Oh. Bamboo shoots. Yeah, actually, the name isn't Wang Wang. It's Terry. And the bloke at Peking Zoo called me Wang Wang. He's the same bloke that christened Chi-Chi and Wing 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 Wing. Why they give a job at that to a bloke with a stammer, I don't know, but there you are. Actually, I'm looking for David Attenborough. Is he here? Bastard. He's been going around saying that pandas are frigid. Now, what I want to know is, how does he know? The thing is, he's blaming it on us male pandas, see? He says we've got extremely small willies. Now, look. I'm not bragging, right? But the bloke up the zoo, he comes into my cage every morning and he takes a sample of sperm, right? And he has no trouble finding my willy, Mr. Attenborough. I mean, it stands to reason, doesn't it? That's why we're called giant pandas, for God's sake.
Gather round and I'll tell you a story of a cashel that fills men with fear. It might make you feel a bit queasy, or it might make you feel a bit queer.
The castle stood high in Kirk Douglas, a wee little town, knock it's true. It was haunted by nosy young pixies and a slimy green bogeyman too, right?
But deep in the bowels of the castle lived the most evil thing that could be. It struck fear in the hearts of the mighty. The ghoulie of Kirk Douglas was he.
He was big and nasty and hairy, and the veins bulged right out of his face. His skin was all warty and wrinkly, but with ghoulies that's often the case.
His shoe was the size of a lifeboat, not to mention the width of his toes. And if you couldn't get near bed and breakfast, you got kicked for the night up his nose.
Now the ghoulie dined chiefly on women. He gobbled them up, never fear. His taste was for pretty young virgins. So he'd no survive long around here, eh?
One day he kidnapped a young lassie called Kirsty MacDonald McBlack. She was large, tasty and saucy, so everyone called her Big Mac.
Now, Kirsty, she had a fine boyfriend. And young Jockin Var was his name. He was noted for tossing the caber, but he went with the girls just the same.
Now when young Jockey found that the monster had stolen his Kirsty away, with his bagpipes he shot up Kirk Douglas, confronting the monster straightway.
The monster, he grabbed our young hero, and Jock screamed out loud with surprise. Oh, but when you're dragged off by the ghoulie, it's bound to bring tears to your eyes.
The monster, he wickedly crushed Jock, and as Jock's life was ebbing away, he reached for his trusty wee bagpipes and mournfully started to play.
The monster's one eye started rolling and a strange grin spread over his face. With a tip-tappy toe, he was dancing like a loony all over the place.
The monster danced high on the turrets, hypnotized by the peepish strange sound, which was played in the key A-flat monster, as the ghoulie fell splat to the ground.
So sinks that great day in Kirk Douglas.
Our lasses are safe from mishap,
'cause they know that all hairy great ghoulies
will always fall into Jock's trap.
don't worry, I will never tell. Your secret is safe with me. They'll never hear it from my lips, 'cause I understand your fears. They laugh as they passed you by. They swear they always knew. Always knew they'd turn away. Don't worry, they'll never hear me say that you're a kind, loving and warm, generous, honest man. That you're a kind, loving and warm, generous, honest man. We've all been let down by our friends, but our enemies are true, rotten to the end. Relations, watch them at the grave. Those who did so little, crocodiles on stage. But you can rely on the checks in the post. We'll always be close. You know where you are with. But let me be perfectly clear, we'll lower taxes next year. You can bet your bottom dollar on. Oh, we must keep in touch. I love you so much. Absolutely bet your life on. Oh, she means nothing to me. I loved your show last night on time. You got a kind, loving and warm, generous, honest man. You can't trust him, he's a kind, loving and warm, generous, honest man. You gotta watch him, he's a kind, loving and warm, generous, honest man. Don't trust him, he's a kind, loving and warm, generous, honest man.
Just a chair. I love this bit. Put your hands through there. Put your hands through it.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Today, story of Goldilocks and the three bears. Okay, one day Goldilocks was walking through a wood and she saw a little house with the smoke coming out.
Wait a second. Whose hands are those there then? Whose hands are those?
They should be my hands, you see, that's the point.
Sit down. Sorry about this, ladies and gentlemen. You put your hands through it, you put that's the trick. Right, I'm going to tell you a joke now. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's all about Goldilocks and three bears that we all know about. Once upon a time, there was the mother bear and the daddy bear. And and a little baby bear. And the mother bear was in the kitchen one day because she was making the porridge for the other two. The daddy bear and smoking. She was she was in the kitchen smoking and making the and drinking. She was smoking and drinking and making the porridge and scratching and making the porridge for the other two. Anyway, they came in early, and the father bear sat down and looked in his bowl and couldn't see anything.
I'm picking my nose.
Put your hands down. And the father bear looked in his bowl and said, "Oh dear, somebody's eating all my porridge." And the punchline comes in a minute. It's much funnier. And the baby bear looked in his bowl and said, "Oh dear, somebody's eating my porridge." And the mother bear just said, "Hang on a minute, please, I haven't made it yet." I'm sorry about that, ladies and gentlemen. It was my big moment. I'm very, very sorry.
What is the first rule of comedy, Dawn?
Well, you said the first rule of comedy was never to apologise.
No, the other first rule of comedy.
Never get carried away with your own jokes. Now get off. Now, off. Get off. Take this with you, please. Thank you very much.
Thank you, young Neil. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Wall of Desire Sauna Club in Milton Keynes for the finals of the British All-In Shouting Championships. As you can hear behind stage, 23 of the world's leading screamers gathered here in this historic new town for the premier event in the world's yelling calendar. Already today we've had 73 decibels from Niels Ogroff, the huge Danish hermaphrodite. But today all ears are on the British champion, a past winner of the Bronze Lung of Zurich. Let's give a big welcome to the man we hope will shout gold for Britain, our very own from the Luton Shouters Club, Howard Binns. Hello. Thank you. Hello, Howard. Sorry, can you come right up in front of the microphone there? Now, Howard, I know you need no introduction.
Roger,
I know you need no introduction. But for those who don't know, how long have you been shouting?
What?
How long have you been shouting?
I've been shouting professionally since 1971, but it's only in the last couple of years that I've been really...
Can I interrupt you there, Howard?
Oh, yes.
Good, carry on.
It's only in the last couple of years I'll be really yelling my head off.
Well, Howard, I think they're ready. So if you're going to get ready for your big shout over there and just explain the rules to you. The shouter has to be prepared to yell a piece of work representative of his or her native culture. And warning also to you in the audience that shouting at international level has now reached such a point where those who are not accustomed to the level of noise can suffer severe internal, possibly irreparable, oral damage. Oh, word of encouragement there from the burly Egyptian champion who'll be shouting the entire Quran later in the evening. So let's, with no further ado, switch on the decibel recorder. Can we have the decibel recorder there, please? There we are, we can see it. Marked off. 85 is the world record, 93 the British record, so we'll see what happens tonight. The
The great moment has come. Are you ready? Into the soundproof box! Right, how it is now. Inside his soundproof box, so let's just test it to see it's working. Would you say something, please, Howard? Howard! Would you say something, please, just to test the box?
Oh!
Thank you. That's fine. Yes, that's fine. Fine! Howard!
That's fine.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, what we've been waiting for. Howard Baines ready now to shout for Britain. The Lady of Shalott by Gary Saunders. Ready? Go on, in your own time. Yes, go on, in your own time. And he's on the way. That which is dead, bubble me up already. His decibel count is going up very well. He's going up 30, 40 long fields of barley and of rye that cover the world and meet the sky. Going up there, it's a red one, he's 1994. He's broken the British, the world record. Howard has done it. He's a red one. Howard has broken the world record. Stop the enthusiasm of the man. So let's rise tonight to Howard Baines, who's become the new world champion and receives the prize that so many shouters through the ages have coveted, the golden bullet of Barnsley.